Well, hello, and Star Wars, Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, 6M3, this is not a cave. We're going to be looking at this today. So, music by John Williams, orchestrated by Herb Spencer. So this is a selection of cues that Herb did, and they're amazing, basically. There's so much in this, it's actually a bit daunting. When I first started to analyze it, I thought, oh no, I might be stumped here. This is going to tax me. Not that others don't, but this was particularly taxing because there's just so much in it. There's a lot of atonality, but it's combined with tonality and sort of selections of sort of what we now call usual sets, so Locrian scales, super Locrian modes, you know, Hungarian minor, a lot of octatonic collections as well, and quite specific intervals. And then if I thought that was complicated, then if I scan forward to here, I found a 12-note row, which is not used other than in its pure form, but it is used canonically, which we'll get to. So it's just, it was one of those cues which just gets more and more difficult. And then finally, when it goes into the sort of horn episode, this bit, I kind of sort of felt safer with that. It's just so complicated. And then we got this stunning chord progression, which is just wonderful in the brass right at the end. Then there's a big sort of run, which is a Lydian sharp 2 scale, so mode 6 of the harmonic minor. And then the lunacy, which is this trumpet sound. I don't know how they played that, really. And then the lunacy of the horn sound. and then we've got this extraordinary sort of pizzicato chord progression here, which I've analysed as well. Which is just brilliant, especially that French sixth to B right at the end. That's just marvellous. I absolutely adore it. So there's an enormous amount in this cue. It's intensely interesting from an analyzer's point of view, an analyst's point of view, and it's also intensely interesting from the composer's point of view. I'm not really an analyst, to be perfectly frank. It's just something I've kind of done just because I've had to. So let's just sort of put it all together. So we'll just start at the beginning. So just in terms of where the source material is, I would refer you to Chris Malone's PDF about putting all the remixes in. So I think this is the Eric Tomlinson original film mix. And sometimes they're slightly different. Things are panned differently, and there's different sort of spacing, and various takes were taken from backup tapes and all sorts of different things. Well, I think this is the original film one. It certainly sounds like it as well. And in terms of the orchestration, it's not something that you would find live, unfortunately, because there are no ARP synths, ARP synths in the live Disney version. And they can't have two pianists for some reason. I don't know why. I think it sounds much better with two pianos, but I guess it's kind of restrictive to certain venues. So we've got electric piano as well as two pianos, and harp and celeste, and an arp synth as well. What else? Four piccolos, four trumpets, two tubas, all sorts of different things. So there's a lot going on in it, and it's super complicated. So I think one of the things which I would hone in on, because it can be very dense and it's difficult to read, so I'll go slowly. I think the thing that makes John Williams interesting with this particular cue is his use of atonalism with octatonic scales and super Locrian scales and everything else. So some of that sort of very gnarly sort of major seventh intervals, which he tends to favour a great deal, which then become super important later on. where we find that he kind of, I'm just sort of having a look at that and thinking, actually, that's just three notes, isn't it? But I think there's a fourth note there. But that looks like 3-1 to me. My first mistake. So he's got a lot of sort of four-note combinations, which he uses quite a lot. So here, for example, which then become very important with, you know, some of the sort of really dense clustered stuff that he does. He tends to use those sort of four notes in chromatic succession. And then that kind of gets more and more interesting, especially when we come on to this sort of tone row, because there's some really interesting things embedded within it, which I kind of think are kind of significant. So we'll come back onto that in a bit, but let's just make some headway. So we start off with a Celestine harp chord, just the harp's just plucking at that point. So it's a sort of a typical dyad, a slightly ambiguous dyad, yet again. Then we've got sort of a diatonic moment just in the basses at that point, and bass clarinets and things. But with it all, that makes a 3-3 chord, augmented chord, and then it just leads to an E pedal. But the point is that we've got this sort of dyad which runs all the way through. And then we've got an interesting bit of harmony here. So let's just take it one step at a time. So the main feature is this collection. So we've got a super Locrian scale. Here it's sort of half octatonic and half whole tone. Halt. That's probably means something in Norwegian. So the octatonic bit is at the end, which is just this little bit here. And then the whole tone bit is the very first few notes with the D as a sort of dividing point between the two tetrachords. I think the reason he uses it, because you can use octatonicism with it. And he does. So we've got this little collection of notes here, which is from T2. So octatonic. So in other words, an octatonic scale starting on D. Remember, there are three. One, two, and three. This is from the third one, but I call it T2 because it's the second semitonal transposition. So that kind of coincides. So this selection of notes coincides with that selection of notes. But then we've got other things which don't coincide with it. And this is where it gets sort of even more complicated. So Williams likes to then sort of mess things up a little bit. So we've got these two major seventh intervals, which then continue. In fact, they just span just three intervals. So it's just a three-note chromatic set at that point. Then it becomes a four-note chromatic set. I think. No, that's still a three-note chromatic set. It eventually becomes a four-note chromatic set. There we go. So we've got sort of 3-1, 3-1, and then 4-1. You can always tell it's chromatic because of the second digit is 1. So that just means chromatic. Three notes. The first one on the left just tells you how many notes there are in the chord complex. So he starts building things up slightly, you know, quite gradually. And then we've got this amazing set of arp synth with a little bit of vibrato. It's set to a sort of sine wave sound, really. Maybe with a little bit of colouring in it and sort of filtering, but not particularly complex sound. We've got all of that combined is a sort of almost chromatic set, five notes or even six notes with it. So it's that, what I mean by that is, you know, often he'll do but then he'll miss out that one and just put a tone like that. So it's almost chromatic, but it's not quite. And that is tends to be a technique that we see quite a lot. Missing out one semitone seems to be an atonal technique that JW uses quite a lot. So we've got an almost chromatic set here, 6-2. Quite difficult to see, really. But then we've also got that as well. Always in edit mode. Especially when combined with the C and the D. And then it all glisses. So, I mean, you know, the pitch almost becomes slightly moot at that point because of the glissando. But it's just the way he puts it all together. Then we've got a little bit of planing going on. So here it goes down a tone. We can see that also happening here. But interesting, it doesn't happen in the harp. So it's, you know, it can be really confusing where he's going down a tone with some notes, but then isn't with others. And that can be sort of, well, why does he do that? I think just simply for variety, I guess. But then we've got these chords, which are really interesting. So we've got sort of F7, but with no fifth. And then we've got an F sharp minor with a six. And then when you put it all together, right at the top, that D sounds really discordant, doesn't it? Like that. And then it just sort of goes down a semitone at the end. So, interestingly enough, that first polychord is a semitonal chord in the sense we've got a sort of F bass chord. But then we've also got an F sharp minor chord here. And then with a D, which is a very familiar chord, minor chord with a flat six. And we can sort of see that in a little pitch class set calculator. And it's 420. And the interesting thing about 420 is that there are different ways of it occurring. So here we've got a major seventh chord. So it's a strange one, really, because of course it can just do that. So you know, the first inversion tends to be actually less of a major seventh chord and more of a minor chord with a flat six. It's a really weird sort of thing that sort of goes on with this, and it can be somewhat confusing as well. I seem to have mucked that up. Let's see if we can just do that. There we go. That's better. And then we've got our 722 chord. So that's a scale that is used pretty convincingly and consistently, our double harmonic scale, of which mode 4 is the Hungarian minor. So 615 is not a subset of it. It's just a chord that he likes the hand shape of, I guess. And then we do have one of those chords. And I think that's interesting because the G of that, I think I'm right in thinking, is that all of those notes form a G Hungarian minor. So we've got G, which is in here. Then we got our A. Then we got our B flat. Then we've got our C sharp, so there. Then we got our F sharp, which is there. E flat, F sharp, and then G. So some of the notes are not necessarily in, you know, a sort of sometimes part of one set. So in this case, Hungarian minor, and then sometimes part of an octatonic set. And this is a good example of where we've got an octatonic collection here. So there, for example, but that's combined with having had a Hungarian minor. So he's got two different sort of things going on at the same time, along with these other little bits of gnarl as well, in terms of major seventh chords, which are all sort of chromatic. With added atonal notes in the bass, But what's interesting about this is that that sort of G harmonic, G Hungarian minor, is replicated to three bars later here. So after all the sort of flurry that we've just had with those trumpets coming in with another chromatic set and all the sort of four piccolos going to the highest note that they possibly can get, then we've got this extraordinary chord that sort of comes out of the ether, almost like, you know, the fog is sort of clearing, except it's not really, it's still rather foggy. So if I sort of play each of those chords, it's G Hungarian minor, but without the G. It just doesn't, it's not there. Because the arp synth at that point has sort of left us. There is still one vaguely there, but it's not present. So it's a really weird thing where you've got sort of all the notes of G Hungarian minor, but not G. And actually, there are five of the notes of G Hungarian minor. But it's definitely a thing that he uses. And then all of these notes are actually part of that set as well, including the harp solo as well. Yeah, so they're all part of it. And then we can see a 4-1, so chromatic set of four notes. Again. And that also reappears against this Hungarian minor. And then it all goes to pot after that, where we've got more chromatic sets as well, right at the top. With some of the notes being picked out, we've got piccolos also doing these sort of sets of four notes. Then we've got a sort of black and white note sort of situation. That sort of idea with highest and lowest clusters. And then essentially we've got, you know, all 12 chromatic notes in play. He's also using microtonality with unstable vibrato, angular, irregular rhythms with small cells interlinked with highly complex, almost aleatoric polyrhythms. In other words, this sort of, you know, if I play it on the piano, you get this sort of really strange effect. I mean, it just sounds a complete mess, of course, on a piano. And we've got really bizarre sort of tuba solo, which comes in at the end quaver. Did the tuba player turn up late for a rehearsal or something? I don't know. I wonder if it's just a joke put in there. I'm not sure. Or just to sort of keep them on their toes. I'm not sure what relationship Williams had with the tuba player of the LSO, but maybe there was something going down. I don't know. It was just quite funny to me, just having a random tuba note in there. So then we've got more chromatic notes at this point, three notes in that cell. We've then got more chromatic pitches as well, hugely angular rhythms and intervals. So, you know, with atonal music, you don't get voice leading, but we do get wide intervals. And at the moments of highest tension, we often get the widest intervals. And it's unsurprising that we get that here. With fully chromatic notes. So that's a B flat, and then A flat. Like that. So again, all 12 notes sort of in play. Then we've got more black note, white note ideas. But often, you know, often he sort of misses out one note instead of that. So he's got a sort of almost a pentatonic scale there. Sort of major pentatonic. Then another one, but on black notes. So it's a sort of, you know, basically just an effect, really. The notes are not important at that point. Then we've got another three note chromatic set, but also against the backdrop of this, we've also got the trombones coming in with an 0-1-3-4 octatonic idea as well. So that is in play with our chromatic notes of four notes or four chromatic notes rather. And then we've got more of a textural build-up of chord clusters here. So maybe sort of think of Threnody, Penderecki, this sort of thing. Because of all of this stuff going on in the violins, this sort of almost cloud clusters. So we've then got bits of the anvil coming in. And you don't, all of this passes by in a matter of seconds. And it really is just effect. But it's interesting to what attention to detail he puts in. And it's the attention to detail that's really interesting. Because here, I noticed something absolutely extraordinary. And this is the first time I've ever seen a 12-note row in Star Wars. Certainly the one that I've looked at. I've only looked at two, really. I've only looked at Phantom Menace and a little bit of New Hope, a little bit of Return of the Jedi, and this one, Empire. But it's really interesting. So it took me a while to sort of work out what the heck was going on. The first step was to work out, are there 12 different pitches? And the answer is yes. So I started looking at the top one first and realized that actually it's the bottom selection of notes which are really the ones of interest. So I wrote them down in a matrix calculator. So instead of using C-sharp, I've used D-flat just to distinguish it, really. You can sort of, some people use sort of all flats and sharps and things like that. So here is an example of that. But you can also use sort of numbers as well if you want to, but I tend to refrain from that because I can, you know, sometimes pitch class set stuff can seem very divorced from the reality of, well, it's just a chord with notes in it. So with this particular example, I'm going to try and make sure that we can see bits of this. We only really need to see P0, but I'll try and explain it. So what I've done is I've literally inputted the pitches D flat C, E flat D, G, A flat or G sharp, same thing, F, E, B flat A, B, and then G flat or F sharp, how it's written here. And what I did with all serial music, I've looked at the intervals. So minor second, minor third, so minor third, minor second, perfect fourth, minor second, augmented second, but basically minor third. Then we've got minor second going on, then diminished fifth, and then minor second, major second, perfect fourth. And it goes another perfect fourth back to the beginning. How on earth does that relate to the top? Well, if you look really closely, look at that E flat to D, G, E flat to D to G, G sharp, F, E, G sharp, F, E, B flat, A, B, F sharp, B flat, A, B, F sharp. So what he's done, cheekily, he started on the third note of the row. So he started here on that E flat, and then he's gone along. So it's a canon, but starting on the third note. And of course, this doesn't have a particular rhythm because it says repeat as fast as possible. So you don't really notice it. But I just thought, well, even though it's quite simple, I mean, he's not transposed anything, he's not inverted anything, he's not retrograded anything. At least there's still that thought behind it, and it's really interesting to see. And I sort of thought, well, I wonder why he chose those specific notes. And then I got thinking, if you have a look at P9, so this is the one, so this is the ninth transposition of the original row. So with serialism, just to explain slightly, the row goes from left to right, and rows are the original material with the original direction of the intervals. All the rows are. P1 is just a one semitone above P0, and P2 is two semitones above the original. I stands for inversion, and that means that all the notes are, we start at the same starting pitch of D-flat, but the intervals are exactly the same, but the opposite direction. So instead of having an E-flat to D going down, we have, C-sharp to C going down, we have a C-sharp to C going down, we have a C-sharp to D going up. In other words, all the notes are reversed. So C to E-flat is going up, so D has to go down to B. B then E flat then goes down to D, therefore B goes up to C, etc. So it literally is a mirror image. But there's nothing like that in Williams's original. But I do want to draw your attention to P9. So let's have a look. B flat, A, C, B. Now, in sort of musical cipher terms, B, A, C, H, or B flat, A, C, B natural, A, C, B flat is a musical cipher of Bach. So I couldn't help thinking, well, that's interesting. And then immediately afterwards, he's got another musical cipher here of E, F, D, and then D flat, which is the same as Dmitri Shostakovich's musical cipher, DSCH, just transposed. And also, incidentally, the DSCH cipher is the 0134, which is another octatonic collection. The remaining set is just four notes, but not quite chromatic, so I don't think that's significant. But I'm sure it's just coincidence, but I couldn't help thinking that there must be something in there. Is that sort of John Williams just basically thinking, well, I can't really be bothered to make a proper 12-tone row, so I'm just going to do what I know. I'm going to use Bach and Shostakovich's thing, cipher, and just put it in. We will never know. I'm sure he probably couldn't remember anyway, even if you asked him, but I thought it was an interesting thing. So then we got this little 12-note row, and then that sort of builds up texturally along with the four piccolos, and then suddenly we've got an almost chromatic tuba solo, which now comes in both of them. So it's almost chromatic, just one note which is not. And then we've got back to an octatonic collection here. So in the second violins, and that remains there. Against that, we've then got more of the chromatic notes. So at this point, again, the four notes, chromatic notes, but in major sevenths. That seems to be a feature along with it. And then more major sevenths here. So we've got little set 3-3, which is just a nice hand position, I think. So I don't think there's much to say about the notes there. That's electric piano and harp at that point. Set 3-2, which is, again, almost a 3-3, but not quite. And then we've got an octatonic set at that point, which also coincides with the octatonic nature of this. And then we get into the more rhythmic stuff as it sort of gets excitedly faster. So this is two octatonic scales, octatonic T1. So the one that starts on C sharp. So all of those notes are present. In the first 12 quavers. And then the last four quavers are octatonic T0. So it's a sudden transposition. All of them are a diminished fifth apart, which is where it's interesting that, the piano is sort of just percussing the accented notes. But I found it strange because in the sketch that was kind of doing the rounds on the internet ages, from ages away, that's marked as a B natural very clearly, but then that breaks the planing, which is really weird. So I wondered whether that was actually Williams's mistake at that point, unless he just sort of thought, no, I don't want everything to be planed, which is also possible, actually, because he doesn't always do what you expect. And, sometimes he does things differently, especially here at the end where he does go I think it is there, but he changes those last notes so that he can get to B. So it's a strange sort of bit of not quite bitonality, but we've kind of got B half dim at that point. So we've got all sorts of different things going on. What else was there to say? I think that's kind of covered that bit at this point. But there is quite a lot of stuff going on. So this is the first time we've got this very distinctive motif. It's not repeated anywhere else. although it was written as part of this cue in the first sort of 26 bars, which we never hear on the film. But it's characterized by block chordal harmony. And it's all minor trans, all planed. Like that, very difficult to play with one hand. And it's quite chromatic. Like that as well, sort of unsurprisingly so, because the whole thing has been quite chromatic. And then the accompaniment itself is also quite chromatic. So we've got set 5-1. So here we've got five chromatic notes. Spotting little errors. First two notes, there we go. So those are repeated. And then, so that idea is repeated a bit later on. I've called it, it's a bit of a fetch to call this unordered notes from P11. Maybe relates more to the 4-1 chromatic major sevenths previously in the Celeste. We'll never know. I mean, I don't think it's particularly related, but it's at least something that gives rise to something else. You know, there are all sorts of little combinations that you can get of those four notes. And then that's going on at the same time as the theme. So we've got this sort of ostinato. And then it changes pretty much going to this sort of F sharp territory. So it's an interesting thing where really the B is the main characteristic, but we've got that as a half diminished diminished interval. So it's interesting that the target note is the F sharp, where we is against the E minor. So that's a real sort of very good example of a wrong bass note against the melody, this time block chordally harmonized. Seems to be a Bartokian trick where actually the tonality of B minor is disguised with chromatic embellishment. So here, so you'll find that in music for strings, percussion and celeste, for example. The melody spans a seven-note chromatic set from F sharp to C, which is also relates to the that sort of span as well. So there are things which are interlinked. Slightly odd orchestration. I can't hear that at all, really. I know it's there. You can just about make it out, but it's very, very difficult to hear on the mix. So block chordal harmony is basically all of what that is. We got that little subtle change. But we often see those half dim chords. They're used very frequently in The Empire Strikes Back, I've noticed. Then we've got a little semitonal shift. Via F now to E. So now the final part of bar 37. So let's just have a quick look at that. Final part of bar 37. There we go. That's now used here, but transposed. So it's unchanged, but it's unchanged but transposed. The violins take on the harmonic role of the main tune. Which is against the wrong note bass. So here we've got E flat minor against E minor, kind of. So it's almost a 6Z19B, but not quite, because it's just that sort of minor chord, but with chromatic embellishment. But I think it very much is E minor, I guess. But it just doesn't have that B natural. And then it's really funny, he suddenly transposed up to a different key. Like that as well. And then ends up on a sort of wrong note bass 417 alpha chord, major minor chord at this point. So it's really interesting how it sort of transpires. And then we've got the whole orchestra along with this as well. Just massive amounts of sound with the entire woodwind section going absolutely, you know, it's the whole sort of auditorium sort of lurching from side to side as they sort of try and regain their composure with 3PO. I'm sure this ground is not entirely stable. No, it's really not stable. Trying to get out of the cave. This is no cave. Yeah, just a really dramatic moment. Notice that the energy is gained with those double time digga 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 digga. Really interesting and sort of repeated as well. Then we've got more tonal now with this sort of almost sounds like a dominant pedal in C minor. We can see that it's C minor. Like that. Again, block chordal against this sort of little accompaniment with another little semitonal shift. And then we've got into E half dim. Like that. So more planing. We've got sort of second inversions. Really, it's just a doubled melody, an octave lower in the trumpets at that point. And then we got some flute filigree. I like the word filigree. So coined by Tim Rodier, apparently, and Ed Buller started using it, and then I started using it. Now Chrysanthi is also using it, and I'm really happy about that. So we've got flute filigree with an unordered scale. There's no particular order to it, apart from it's got some semitones and tones in it, but it's not a particular scale. There we go. It just sort of creeps up chromatically after this. But beforehand, it doesn't. Like that. Some sort of half octatonic, half diatonic, half chromatic. really sort of extraordinary. And then we've got a nice little 6Z19. We can't get away with... get away from 6Z19 with John Williams. It's always there at some stage, and therefore Hungarian minor derived, because it's the principal subset of that. And then we've now got an inverted bass where it's going up instead of down. Now it's going up. And then a chromatic shift. And then we've got this extraordinary chord progression, which I played right at the beginning. So the first time we really get into sort of proper tonality. So here we've got A flat, first inversion. Now, I want to draw your attention to the sonority of this. So it is interesting. So here he is repeating the third in the first octave and then... and not repeating it anywhere else. So all first inversions until here. And it's a slightly ambiguous chord because you're expecting the B flat, I think. But he doesn't ever iterate it. It perhaps gets in the way. And it's it is here. But it's nowhere in the brass. And this is a sort of good example of less is more sometimes. So we've got in the trombones, all thirds. And we got that. So it goes to a seventh. And horns. And then to the third. And then trumpets. Parallel. Like that. So it's a really interesting sort of form of stunning orchestration where the third is repeated, but only the first principal voice, and then the B flat is not repeated. It seems more stark. And then we get to D major. I mean, that's a real, real C change from A flat. It's a real, you can't really get any further. Here we've got a simple double root position with the trumpets taking the same top line as the horns, and then more first inversions. And even that is interesting. Sort of F minor, but with an A flat, so it doesn't sound very minor. And then here we've got D flat, again with the omitted third, but it's in the strings, sort of almost a sort of Italian six, I guess. And then it goes to C. So that chord progression is really interesting because we've got that sort of almost like a sort of Neapolitan kind of. Not really, because it's not a major chord to one, it's a minor chord to one, and in fact it's a diminished chord to one, half diminished chord to one. But it still behaves like a sort of regular augmented sixth resolution. In other words, the top notes go outwards. Like that. And really everything is just colorization of the outward notes. It's a really interesting sort of oral exercise. Really weird. Yeah, just interesting from both an orchestration voicing point of view, in terms of what to do with first inversions, where it's really strong and powerful. And then changing chord. As it progresses. Which is really interesting. And then we've got this little sort of march-like complex syncopated melodic cell in C minor. Bum bum ba dum bum 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 dum bum ba dum bum bum ba dum. And interesting, it hits this note, this sort of brillante a little bit, halfway through the bar. So we've got an A flat Lydian sharp 2, so mode 4 of C harmonic minor. I'm kind of taking the bass as the sort of the pedal note, and also so that's why I've called it A flat Lydian sharp 2. It could be, you know, just C harmonic minor, but I guess it's more like a sort of Lydian sharp 2 at that point. You know, this sort of reminds one of sort of the Yoda theme coming up later. So it goes up in tuplets with this sort of little interplay in the trombones and tubas. A flat pedal timpani brings us into the final sort of flourish of this with some filigree, which is all dovetailing. And really, we just hear this extraordinary trumpet line. Like this, A flat minor over G. So a good example of 419. Minor chord with a major seventh. In fact, I'm sure that's 420. I think I'm going a bit mad. Let's just have a look. I'm pretty sure it is. I think it is 4. Oh no, it's 419. Gosh. Shows me. Minor chord with a major seventh, yes. That was right. Sometimes you sort of look at yourself and go, huh? Yeah, minor chord with a major seventh. So the Star Wars chord. Unusual to have the seventh in the A flat texture as well. So here we've all got A flats in the trumpet, but it's not present anywhere else. But it is in the wind and it is in the strings. And we've got this sort of wonderful sextuplets going on. And then we've got this crazy horn bit. Unbelievably hard, all block chordal chromatic planing, typical Ravel, although I'm not sure if he does it this quickly in this context. See also Petrushka, and of course Debussy for parallelisms, and like countless other composers as well. So we still maintain that. Oh, that's an interesting chord, wasn't it? That's a surprise. So A flat minor with G. And then we got the final diverging progression. So what I mean by that is it starts sort of in the middle and it goes outwards to the extremes. to B. So interesting progression from A flat minor. Then we got second inversion B minor, second inversion D minor. And what's happening here is that there are three different procedures going on. So the first one is roots ascending minor thirds. So the root of one note, sorry, the third of one note becomes the root of the next chord. And it would keep going like that. It's a sort of reminds one of Lord of the Rings. But he doesn't do that. So he does for a bit. But notice that the bass note's changing. The bass note's now going down a third, but now he's just completely changed from D minor to G minor. So that's not part of that sort of tertiary progression at all. And here he's using a sort of semitonal auxiliary chord. In other words, it's going G minor, a semitone away to F sharp minor, and then back to G minor. And then that becomes part of the next progression, which is minor chords, but a major third apart. So the sort of imperial sort of idea. That sort of idea. So here we've got G minor and then E flat minor. And then he stays on the same pitch, sort of enharmonically alters it so that it's not descending anymore. And then to a C7 flat 5, but actually it's kind of C, imagine it's an A sharp at the top, and it becomes a French 6 with a regular progression to B, just the bass. So it's a really extraordinary progression. I might try and open the, this isn't okay, you can see, those are my scores. Quite a few of them. It's just so many, it's ridiculous. Hopefully this should open. Let's just go for a quick save as well, just in case things go awry. So this is the chord progression here, just on note performer. So exciting with the strings. Let's have a nice shout out to the Glockenspiel at this point. Now, I've included this because I think written it's just the last few notes. But I think the player came in early and then thought, oh no, and then looked at the conductor and thought, oh, beat three, I need to play those notes. I'm not sure. Anyway, I'm going to play it again, then we'll keep going. Very rich thirds and sevenths. It's a jazz thing. That's our C minor. Brilliant. And then that tam-tam at the end. Absolutely extraordinary piece. It really is. And so exhilarating as well. It's just got everything in it that you kind of need. But that last progression is just really crazy. A-flat over A-flat minor over G. It's just, you know, there's just so much going on. I love it. All of this is just harmonic fudge. Like that. With the piano, it makes actually a huge difference. Adding the harp won't make a huge difference because I haven't really added it very much. Then we got the Glock. Just get a little sort of tinkle right at the end. Whoops. And then with all the woodwind, so this is all the stuff that's kind of I wouldn't say it's non-essential, but it's all the accompanying materials. It's not the principal idea. Like that. And what we really want is this amazing brass Wow. I mean, that's just so fast. And it must be very, very difficult to do when you've heard and then to do just normal semiquavers afterwards, really at the top of the instrument. And then we've got this amazing brass divergent progression, which comes in as well with pizzicato just at the beginning of the notes. There we go. And I'm sure there's, I think, some slight strange things going on enharmonically there. But what a remarkable, and then very, very low. So if I put it in transposing score, even there it's really low. So definitely bass clef territory at that point. And classic to do sort of pizzicato with the first iteration of the notes. That's sort of classic orchestration as well. I love this progression here, just the brass. Let's listen to that at this point. Sort of very Holstein. Really remarkable. It just works tremendously well. And then with all of the strings in unison, this is an example of orchestral differentiation. So we've got bass line, we've got the harmony, and then we've also got the accompaniment. The harmony is actually the tune as well. Interesting, if you compare that with, I'm trying to think of the lighting of the beacons of Gondor, for example, very similar in terms of the sort of, you know, it's a really pungent progression, but for some reason this sort of seems to be more exciting. I think it's that leap going from here down to that seventh chord. It's really interesting. And then ends up on a major chord because everything here has sounded quite minor. Yeah. Now major chord, C change. And that chord here, you know, the sort of sforzando then crescendo. I mean, it's just so powerful. It sort of really gives you that feeling of expectancy. This is the D flat, half dim, but omitting the third of that chord. And he does it again here as well. Just a remarkable piece of writing, really. And that really is the most tonal aspects of what's going on, apart from all of the sort of bum, bum, ba-da-da-dum, bum, ba-dum. Which works really, really well, especially with this sort of chugging bass. It's really interesting, especially with two pianos. So orchestral blend because the strings are with the harp, with the horns. Differentiation. Feeling of real sort of exhilaration at that point. I urge you to just sort of listen to it again and again. It's just a really extraordinary bit of writing, really, of composition, film composition specifically. It's just wonderful. And all of this sort of atonal stuff kind of feels really insignificant when you've heard all of that amazing sort of final payoff. And I think that's the beauty of this cue, is that there's all this sort of gnarly stuff at the beginning, and then there's this huge sort of emotional excitement as the Millennium Falcon flies convincingly, just as the jaws and the teeth sort of try and grab it, which would have been a complete disaster, and everything would have ended at that point had that occurred. Yeah, a remarkable cue. I think beloved by the community, definitely. I think people like that cue particularly. And then there's quite a bit of time until the start of the next cue. So as we look ahead, I've got, I hope Frank doesn't mind me sharing his work in progress. This is not the final version, I hasten to add, but this is Frank Lehmann, who's just made such a remarkable contribution to, I mean, really, he's the place to go, I think, really. Remarkable contribution to scholarship and Star Wars music and all sorts of other types of music in general as well. Just phenomenal. So then we've got, we don't have Training a Jedi because that's not actually part of the film, very sadly. So I will come back to that at one point after The Empire has finished, after I've done the end credits. We'll look at some of the music that wasn't written. There's bits of during the battle lines, I think, and Snow Battle, which didn't make it as well. Then we've got the last cue, if you have seen the live version of this, which is the Magic Tree 6M5 and 7M1. I've then gone on a little bit, and we've got Attack Position, which is quite short, I think. Yoda Raises the Ship, fantastic. Vader's Command, we don't know who orchestrated it. It's quite short. Then City in the Clouds, Lando's Palace, or Sibelius's Violin Concerto. I think one of them is very, very similar. But it's not a rip-off. It's just a reverential nod. And I like that Williams disguise makes no attempt to disguise it, as I think Frank's already pointed out. Then we got Luke to the Rescue, Vader shows up. I think I've got as far as that in terms of doing full score, putting 3PO together, Trouble in Prison, Carbon Freeze, Luke pursues the captives, Chewie chokes Lando, Through the Window, Losing Hand, Hyperspace, Finale, end credits. Wow. So we're coming really to this, the main meat of the action at this point. So it's a really interesting, it's been a fascinating film to do, actually. And what's wonderful is also having Xanthi's Star Wars Music Minute blogs as well, vlogs, which are just fantastic podcast. Please do have a listen to it. Frank was actually on this week's episode. Obviously, there's a bit of a time delay between our various cues. I'm trying to think, how can I do 5 minutes a week? I can't. It's just too difficult. So at some point, I'm sure Xanthi will overtake me, but it doesn't matter too much because, of course, the beauty of YouTube is you can just watch them after things have gone live. So anyway, that's kind of where we're at. What a remarkable cue. I've had fun sort of trying to explain it. Sorry if it got a bit bogged down in the the serial stuff. It is a bit cerebral, isn't it? All of that sort of thinking about all these hidden musical ciphers and things. But it is something which interests me particularly. I know BACH was interested in musical ciphers and stuff like that. They can be quite crass sometimes. But if you're interested, there is, if I can find this, an interesting one by Robert Schumann called Carnaval, which is a wonderful piece for piano. And there's these little musical cryptograms called the Sphinxes. And of course, Sphinxes were known for their riddles. And he's got a recurring motif of four notes, which are slightly changed. So we've got A-S-C-H. It's pronounced S, but it's actually an E-flat. That sort of idea. And then I think Clara Schumann came from the town of Ash. So there's another one. And then we've got E-flat, E-C-H-A. I'm trying to remember what that was, and I can't remember. but I'm sure there is a sort of an interesting thing about that. Ash in German for ash. But also, that's interesting. I'm pretty sure, yes, the first two spell the name for the town Ash, now Ash in Czech Republic, in which Schumann's then fiancée was born. The sequence of letters and also appears in the German word Fasching, meaning carnival, and addition Ash, German for ash. So all of these sort of crazy little sort of things in there. But often we do find them. And there's a whole sort of little Wikipedia article about the Bach motif. There's another one with the C-sharp minor prelude, which is also an octatonic opening, which is an interesting one. But all sorts of different things. Sort of Ravel was interested, Charles Kirchlin, Bax, Poulenc, all of those sort of French guys. And various other things. There's a whole list of them here. So if you're interested in that sort of thing, then that's definitely something to have a look at. That's kind of it, really. So we'll try and do some more on... I'm kind of very interested in the way Williams uses atonalism. It's really complicated because he often combines these scales with other things to make sort of 12-tone music. And I think it would be good to experiment with a little bit because it's sort of something that we don't really see very often in sort of composition videos, I think. So I'll try and do a little series on it. One of the best books actually was something I found earlier today, which I think was something to do with Reginald Smith Brindle. So where was it? This is from a book about composing. I think it's just by Reginald Smith Brindle. He must be English. Can't be an American with that name. But it's interesting because he does talk about why certain things work. And basically his theory is that it's all to do with the intervals and wide intervals achieve a much more important, that much more importance than in tonal music. And essentially that's kind of how you derive excitement, progression and recession. We've looked at that before. Usually from intervallic content, and so at points of high tension, often those things tend to be quite chunky and disparate and angular, in which case here, for example, and also here. But there are different types of melody, because of course you might get a slow melody as well, so you know, those are also considerations. So the interesting thing is where Williams combines atonality with other things, other examples of tonality, where the intervals are actually not particularly wide, they're very close together, but it creates space for something. So for example, here in the orchestration, you'll see lots of very high notes, but there's space in the middle for this ARP synth to sort of shine through a little bit, and that's just taking up bass stuff, and then very, very high Celeste, don't forget, it sounds an octave higher. So there's a lot to think about with it, and to experiment with, so I hope you will, and look forward to seeing you next time.